द कंप्लीट वर्क्स ऑफ स्वामी विवेकानंदा प्रैक्टिकल वेदांता द वे टू द रियलाइजेशन ऑफ अ यूनिवर्सल रिलीजन पार्ट टू। आई मेट अ मॉर्मन जेंटलमैन इन दिस कंट्री हु ट्राइड टू परसुएड मी टू हिज फेथ। आई सेड आई हैव ग्रेट रिस्पेक्ट फॉर योर ओपिनियंस बट इन सर्टन पॉइंट्स वी डू नॉट एग्री। आई बिलोंग टू अ मोनेस्टिक ऑर्डर and you believe in marrying many wives. But why don't you go to India to preach? Then he was astonished. He said, why you don't believe in any marriage at all? And we believe in polygamy, and yet you ask me to go to your country? I said, yes, my countrymen will hear every religious thought, wherever it may come from. I wish you would go to India first because I am a great believer in sects. Secondly, there are many men in India who are not at all satisfied with any one of the existing sects, and on account of this dissatisfaction, they will not have anything to do with religion, and possibly you might get some of them. The greater the number of sects, the more chance of people getting religion. In the hotel, where there are all sorts of food, everyone has a chance to get his appetite satisfied. So I want sects to multiply in every country, that more people may get a chance to be spiritual. Do not think that people do not like religion. I do not believe that. The preachers cannot give them what they need. The same man that may have been branded as an atheist, as a materialist or what not, may meet a man who gives him the truth needed by him, and he may turn out to become the most spiritual man of the community. We can eat only in our way. For instance, we Hindus eat with our fingers. Our fingers are suppler than yours. You cannot use your fingers the same way. Not only the food you should be supplied, but it should also be taken in your particular way. Not only must you have spiritual ideas, but they must come to you according to your own method. They must speak your own language, the language of your soul, and then alone will they satisfy you. When the man comes who speaks my language and gives truth in my language, I at once understand it and receive it forever. This is a great fact. Now from this we see that there are various grades and types of human beings, various grades and types of human minds, and what a task religion takes upon them. A man brings forth two or three doctrines and claims that his religion ought to satisfy all humanity. He goes out into the world, God's menagerie, with a little cage in his hand and says, God and the elephant, and everybody has to go into this. He must go in. Again, there may be a sect with a few good ideas. Its followers say, all men must come in. But there is no room for them. Never mind, cut them into pieces. Get them in anyhow. And if they don't get in, why, they will be damned. No preacher, no sect have I ever met that pauses and asks, why is it that people do not listen to us? Instead, they curse the people and say, these people are wicked. They never ask, how is it that people do not listen to my words? Why cannot I make them see the truth? Why cannot I speak their language? Why cannot I open their eyes? Surely they ought to know better. And when they find people do not listen to them, and when they find people do not listen to them, if they curse anybody, it should be themselves. But it is always the people's fault. They never try to make their sect large enough to embrace everyone. Therefore, we at once see why there has been so much narrow-mindedness. The part always claiming to be the whole. The little finite unit always laying claim to the infinite. Think of the little sects born within a few hundred years out of the fallible human brains, making this arrogant claim of knowledge of the whole of God's infinite truth. Think of the arrogance of it. If it shows anything, it is this: how vain human beings are. And how it is no wonder that such claims have always failed, and by the mercy of the Lord are always destined to fail. In this line, the Mohammedans were best off. Every step forward was made with the sword. The Quran in the one hand and the sword in the other. Take the Quran or you must die. There is no alternative. You know from history how phenomenal was their success. For 600 years, nothing could resist them. And then there came a time when they had to cry halt. So will it be with the other religions. If they follow the same methods, we are such babes. We always forget human nature. When we began life, we think that our fate will be something extraordinary and nothing can make us believe that. But when we grow old, we think differently. So also with religions. In their early stages, they spread a little. They get the idea that they can change the minds of the whole human race in a few years. And so on, going killing and massacring to make converts by force. Then they fail and begin to understand better. We see that these sects did not succeed in what they started out to do, which was a great blessing. Just think if one of these fanatical sects had succeeded all over the world, where would man be today? Now the Lord be blessed that they did not succeed. Yet each one represents a great truth. Each religion represents a particular excellence, something which is its soul. There is an old story which comes to my mind. There were some ogresses who used to kill people and do all sorts of mischief. But they themselves could not be killed until someone found that their souls were in certain birds. And so long as these birds were safe, nothing could destroy these ogresses. So each one of us has, as it were, such a bird where our soul is, has an ideal, a mission to perform in life. Every human being is an embodiment of such an ideal, such a mission. Whatever else you may lose, so long as that ideal is not lost and that mission is not hurt, nothing can kill you. Wealth may come and go, misfortune may pile mountains high, but if you have kept the ideal entire, nothing can kill you. You may have grown old, even 100 years old, but if that mission is fresh and young in your heart, what can kill you? But when that ideal is lost and that mission is hurt, nothing can save you. All the wealth, all the power in the world will not save you. And what are the nations but multiplied individuals? So each nation has a mission of its own to perform in this harmony of human races. And so long as that nation keeps to that ideal, that nation nothing can kill. But if that nation gives up its mission in life and goes after something else, its life becomes short and it vanishes. And so also it is with religions. The fact that all these old religions are living today proves that they must have kept that mission intact. In spite of all their mistakes, in spite of all difficulties, in spite of all quarrels, in spite of all the incrustation of the forms and figures, the heart of every one of them is sound. It is a throbbing, beating, living heart. They have not lost any one of them, the great mission they came for. And it is so splendid to study that mission. Take Mohammedanism, for instance. Christian people hate no religion in the world so much as Mohammedanism. They think it is the very worst form of religion that ever existed. As soon as a man becomes a Mohammedan, the whole of Islam receives him as a brother with open arms without making any distinction, which no other religion does. If one of your American Indians becomes a Mohammedan, the Sultan of Turkey will have no objection to dine with him. If he has brains, no position is barred to him. In this country, I have never seen a church where the white man and the Negro can kneel side by side to pray. Just think of that. Islam makes its followers all equal. So that you see in the peculiar excellence of Mohammedanism. In many places in the Quran, you will find very sensual ideas of life. Never mind. Mohammedanism came to preach to the world this practical brotherhood of all belonging to their faith. That is the essential part of the Mohammedan religion. And all the other ideas about heaven and of life, etc., are not Mohammedanism. They are just accretions. With the Hindus, you will find one national idea, spirituality. In no other religion, in no other sacred books or text in the world, you will find so much energy spent in defining the idea of God. They tried to define the idea of the soul so that no earthly touch might mar it. The spirit must be defined, and the spirit understood as spirit must not be made into a man. The same idea of unity, of the realization of God, of omnipresent, is preached throughout. They think it is all nonsense to say that he lives in heaven and all that. It is a mere human, anthropomorphic idea. All the heaven that ever existed is now and here. One moment in infinite time is quite as good as any other moment. If you believe in a God, you can see him even now. We think religions begin when you have realized something. It is not believing in doctrines, nor giving intellectual assents, nor making declarations. If there is a God, have you seen him? If you say no, then what right have you to believe in him? If you are in doubt whether there is a God, why do you not struggle to see him? Why do you not renounce the world and spend the whole of your life for this one object? Renunciation and spirituality are the two great ideas of India. And it is because India clings to these ideas that all her mistakes count for so little. With the Christians, the central idea that has been preached by them is the same. Watch and pray, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Which means, purify your minds and be ready. and that spirit never dies. You recollect that the Christians are, even in the darkest days, even in the most superstitious Christian countries, always trying to prepare themselves for the coming of the Lord by trying to help others, building hospitals and so on. So long as the Christians keep to that ideal, their religion lives. Now, an ideal presents itself to my mind, it may be only a dream. I do not know whether it will ever be realized in this world or not. But sometimes it is better to dream a dream than to die on hard facts. Great truths, even a great in a dream, are good, better than bad facts. So let us dream a dream. You know that there are various grades of minds. You may be a matter of fact, common sense rationalist. You do not care for forms and ceremonies. You want intellectual, hard, ringing facts, and they alone will satisfy you. Then there are the Puritans, the Mohammedans, who will not allow a picture or statue in their place of worship. Very well. But there is another who is more artistic. He wants a great deal of art, beauty of lines and curves, the colors of flowers, forms. He wants candles, lights, and all these insignia, the paraphernalia of ritual, and he may see God. His mind takes God in those forms, as yours takes him through the intellect. Then there is the devotional man, whose soul is crying for God. He has no other idea but to worship God and to praise him. Then again, there is the philosopher, standing outside all these, mocking at them. He thinks, what nonsense they are. What ideas about God? They may laugh at one another, but each one has a place in this world. All these various minds, all these various types are necessary. If there ever is going to be an ideal religion, it must be broad and large enough to supply food for all these minds. It must supply the strength of philosophy to the philosopher, the devotee's heart to the worshipper. To the realist, it will give all that the most marvelous symbolism can convey. To the poet, it will give as much of heart as he can take in, and all other things besides. To make such a broad religion, we will have to go back into the time when religions began and take them all in. Our watchword then will be acceptance and not exclusion. Not only toleration, for so-called toleration is often blasphemy, and I do not believe in it. I believe in acceptance. Why should I tolerate? Toleration means that I think that you are wrong and I am just allowing you to live. Is it not a blasphemy to think that you and I are allowing others to live? I accept all religions that were in the past and worship with them all. I worship God with every one of them, in whatever form they worship him. I shall go to the mosque of the Mohammedan. I shall enter the Christian's church and kneel before the crucifix. I shall enter the Buddhist temple, where I shall take refuge in Buddha and in his law. I shall go into the forest and sit down in meditation with the Hindu who is trying to see the light which enlightens the heart of everyone. Not only shall I do these, but I shall keep my heart open for all that may come in the future. Is the book finished? Or is it still a continuous revelation going on? It is a marvelous book. These spiritual revelations of the world, the Bible, the Vedas, the Quran, and all the other sacred books are but so many pages, and an infinite number of pages remain yet to be unfolded. I would leave it open for all of them. We stand in the present, but open ourselves to the infinite future. We take in all that has been in the past, enjoy the light of the present, and open every window of the heart for all that will come in the future. Salutation to all the prophets of the past, to all the great ones of the present, and to all that are to come in the future.